subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Yoga event is held here.
Severe injustice, and they should be stopped.
We should raise our voices.
Condemn this brutal act.
Hello viewers, welcome to Newspeak South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Indian security forces foil terror attacks by ISIS in capital New Delhi. Pakistan accepts sheltering India's most wanted terrorist Daud Ibrahim. India's investigative agency files charge sheet in Pulwama terror attack case. Jaish Chief Masood Azhar main plotter. And violence continues unabated in Afghanistan amid peace deal initiatives. The Islamic State is trying to spread its network in India by misleading the youth and persuading them to carry out terror attacks. In a recent incident, Abu Yusuf, an alleged ISIS terrorist, was arrested in capital New Delhi with arms and ammunitions. He was planning to carry out an attack but was foiled by the security agencies. A report.
A deadly terror attack thwarted by security agencies in New Delhi. These men in uniform are using the latest anti-terror technology to find every single clue about the modus operandi of Abu Yusuf Khan, a suspected ISIS terrorist arrested from the Indian capital after a brief gunfight. Hailing from Balrampur city of Uttar Pradesh, Abu Yusuf was riding a motorcycle and carrying two pressure cookers turned into IEDs with about 15 kilograms of explosives in them. He also possessed a pistol with four live cartridges. Abu Yusuf, who was in direct touch with ISIS commanders, planned a terror strike in the city on Independence Day, which was foiled by heavy security system in New Delhi.
2015 mein jab aaya to iska first handler tha Yusuf Al Hindi. Yusuf Al Hindi jo hai isko usne isko initially initiate kiya. रेडिकलाइजेशन किया इसका और इसको आईएसआईएस का अपना पार्ट बनाया. खुरासान प्रोविंस का जो आईएस मॉड्यूल है, आईएसकेपी जिसे कहते हैं, उसमें अली हुजैफा पाकिस्तानी इसका हैंडलर रहा. हुजैफा पाकिस्तानी ने इसको सीरिया आने का भी, सॉरी खुरासान आने का भी प्रॉमिस किया था कि आपको खुरासान लाएंगे फैमिली के साथ में. बट जब लास्ट ईयर वो ड्रोन स्ट्राइक में मारा गया तो जो नया हैंडलर था इसका, जो नया अमीर है आईएसकेपी का, उसने इसको इंस्ट्रक्शन दिए कि आप वहीं पर इंडिया में ही कोई एक्शन कीजिए. उस डायरेक्शन के तहत के लिए दिल्ली में आया था. किसी हैवी फुटफॉल एरिया में इसको ये आईडीज प्लांट करनी थी और इसको ये भी इंस्ट्रक्शन थी कि ये जब वापस लौट जाएगा यहाँ ये कार्रवाई करके तो उसके बाद इसे फिदाइन करना था.
द अरेस्ट इन दिल्ली कम्स डेज आफ्टर अ डॉक्टर वाज अरेस्टेड इन बेंगलुरु सिटी फॉर अलेज्ड लिंक्स टू आईएसआईएस. 28 ईयर ओल्ड अब्दुल रहमान, हु वर्कड एज एन ऑप्थेल्मोलॉजिस्ट एट अ मेडिकल कॉलेज इन द सिटी, वाज अरेस्टेड by the National Investigation Agency based on intelligence from a couple arrested in Delhi in March. After the arrest, the NIA carried out searches at three premises belonging to Abdul Rahman and seized digital devices, a mobile phone and laptop containing incriminating material. A UN report on terrorism has already warned that there are significant numbers of ISIS terrorists in Indian subcontinent who are planning terror strikes in the region.
Pakistan's agenda has been to spoil the basic fabric of democracy wherever there is democracy, and their agenda has been that we should वी शुड ऑलवेज गो इन टू कंट्रीज एंड ISI इज वेरी वेल नोन. ISI इज अ इंटेलिजेंस एजेंसी ऑफ द पाकिस्तान आर्मी एंड इट इज वेरी वेल नोन दैट पाकिस्तान इंडल्जेस इन टू ऑल दीज थिंग्स एंड पाकिस्तान एजेंट्स डू हैव टेररिस्ट into various countries. They plant these people, the ISI plants terrorists, and such activities are conducted. So now it is time for all the countries to come together and raise a strong voice and put sanctions against Pakistan and take some strong action against Pakistan.
Terror groups in this geographical region of Pakistan and Afghanistan have spread its influence mostly by co-opting with Pakistan-based terrorist factions, including Lashkar-e-Jhangvi al-Alami, Jundullah, and Jamaat-ul-Ahrar, among others. The group has garnered much of its strength and influence through its covert network of extremists in Pakistan, who have sworn allegiance to Islamic State. Despite Pakistan remaining on the grey list of Financial Action Task Force, it continues to help and fund these terrorists to carry out terror strikes.
That Pakistan is now indulging into the world scenario as far as terrorism is concerned. And this now should be raised with a loud voice that Pakistan is a terror country, block all everything, and put sanctions on Pakistan and let us all stop all relations with Pakistan.
Amid the COVID-19 pandemic, the terror groups like the Islamic State and Al-Qaeda are on recruitment spree by using social media. They easily mislead the youth and force them to commit terror attacks. Indian police confirmed that Abu Yusuf too came in contact with Islamic State through social media. Thus, apart from stemming radicalization, it is critical to closely watch threats emerging from online space in the region.
Pakistan remains a safe haven for dreaded terrorists who are behind major terror attacks across the world, including neighboring India and Afghanistan. Several reports have time and again exposed Pakistan's truth, though it was loath to accept it. However, in order to avoid the wrath of international community, Pakistan recently admitted and issued an official gazette notification saying that it has been sheltering 88 terrorists on its soil, including Daud Ibrahim Kaskar, a terrorist, mobster and drug dealer most wanted by India. We bring your report.
Be it lavish houses or safe training grounds, terrorists get it all easily in Pakistan. They enjoy the patronage of Pakistan's security agencies and play a significant role in the country's internal and external security affairs. Underworld Don and proscribed terrorist Dawood Ibrahim Kaskar is one among hundreds of them living and enjoying a splendid lifestyle in the country. Dawood is the mastermind of the 1993 serial blast in India's Mumbai city. He has long been on India's most wanted list, but successive Pakistan governments have always denied his existence there. In 2003, the US also declared Ibrahim as a specially designated global terrorist. After denying this truth for years, Pakistan has been forced to acknowledge the presence of fugitive underworld Don and terrorists on its soil. In an attempt to be dropped from the Financial Action Task Force's grey list, Pakistan has banned 88 new terrorists in compliance with the new list issued by the United Nations Security Council, UNSC. The list also revealed three addresses of Dawood Ibrahim in Karachi. Pakistan has revealed that Dawood Ibrahim not only has his bases in the country, but has multiple aliases and passports issued by the country.
Pakistan published a special SRO in which they have laid a lot of restrictions for the movement, travel, etc., etc., on 80 personnel who are in the United Nations Security Council prohibited list. One amongst them is the infamous Dawood Ibrahim, who was involved in the 1993 blast and has been involved in a number of terrorist activities, sponsorship, in India over the years. He is a critical asset of the Inter-Services Intelligence, or the ISI of Pakistan. It is a well-established fact that he has been staying in Karachi, in Dubai, and traveling to Dubai and various other places with impunity.
It is for the first time that Pakistan officially accepted the presence of dreaded terrorists in its territory. There have been several others after Dawood, including Hafiz Saeed, the chief of Jamaat-ud-Dawah, Masood Azhar, the head of Jaish-e-Mohammed, and Zakiur Rehman Lakhvi of Lashkar-e-Taiba. However, the move seems nothing but Pakistan's tactics to mislead the international community and to avoid facing the heat from the Paris-based Financial Action Task Force and escape the economic sanctions from various foreign financing institutions and countries allied with Pakistan. Pakistan has been in the grey list since June 2018 and was given a warning in February this year to complete a 27-point action plan by June 2020. The FATF extended the June deadline to September due to the spread of coronavirus that disrupted the FATF plenary meetings. However, if Pakistan fails to comply with the FATF directive by October, then it could push the country onto the blacklist.
See, since the time Pakistan has started to tilt towards China and get into their lap, the Western powers and all those who control the monetary organizations which lend money to Pakistan, they are tightening the noose on Pakistan. And it is a result of this tightening of the noose that Pakistan has finally agreed to Dawood's presence in their country, which in their national interest, they were never willing to go by that, what India has been alleging Pakistan. So in the longer perspective, this is a very good thing that is happening. Pakistan is coming under pressure, and it is also indicative that Pakistan is looking for some desperate measures to overcome its economy, and these are the signs of desperation when Pakistan divulges that Dawood is in their control.
As Pakistan has accepted the presence of Dawood Ibrahim in Karachi, the question now arises is, will it hand him over to India?
What India and the global community need to do is to continue to imply pressure on Pakistan so that it takes full action as is expected of it on all the terrorists that it is housing, that it is providing safe havens to, and also that Dawood Ibrahim is handed back to India so that action can be taken and a case can be instituted against it for the 1993 bomb blast in Mumbai, as also the 2008 November terrorist attack in India, particularly in Mumbai. This is essential if we have to have closure as far as the cases, as far as the terrorist actions that Dawood Ibrahim has taken against India.
Pakistan government has ordered the seizure of all movable and immovable properties of 88 terror outfits and individuals and freezing of their bank accounts. But it is to be seen as how Pakistan will act against these dreaded terrorists in the days to come.
India has once again accused Pakistan for giving protection to terrorists who are responsible for major terror attacks in the region. In February 2019 Pulwama attack case, Indian investigating agency has filed a charge sheet naming Jaish-e-Mohammed chief Masood Azhar and his brother as main plotters. We have a report.
14 February 2019, Pulwama terrorist attack. 40 Indian security personnel martyred. Jaish-e-Mohammed outfit claims responsibility. These heart-wrenching visuals of the Pulwama terror attack reminds the massive loss Indian security forces suffered in Jammu and Kashmir last year. Adil Ahmed Dar, a local from Pulwama district and a member of Jaish-e-Mohammed, blew himself up
along with the explosive-laden vehicle into the convoy of Central Reserve Police Force. After 18 months of the horrific incident, the National Investigation Agency has filed a 13,500-page charge sheet in the terror attack, naming Jaish-e-Mohammed chief Maulana Masood Azhar, his brother Abdul Rauf Asgar, and 17 others.
Well, who is Masood Azhar? Masood Azhar is a man who was let off when one of our aircraft, civil aircraft, Indian Airlines, was hijacked to Kabul. And then after that, he was head of the Jaish-e-Mohammed. When Jaish-e-Mohammed was banned, then the United Nations also called him a terrorist. But China refused to accept him. The whole National Investigative Agency has unearthed the whole diabolic plot, and they have been charged in the Jammu court. A very interesting development, as our intelligence agencies are getting more perceptive to get to the bottom of this terrorism acts, which don't seem to be reducing but becoming more and more clever.
India has always been vocal about Pakistan's role in the Pulwama terror attack. However, after the formal filing of the charge sheet, India's Ministry of External Affairs slammed Pakistan for evading responsibility for the Pulwama terror attack. It hit out at Pakistan for sheltering dreaded terrorists who are responsible for terror attacks in Indian soil.
Jaish-e-Mohammed had claimed responsibility for the Pulwama attacks. The organization and its leadership is in Pakistan. It is regrettable that Masood Azhar, the first accused in the charge sheet, continues to find shelter in Pakistan. We have shared enough evidence with Pakistan, but it continues to evade responsibility. It may also be recalled that Pakistan has not yet taken any credible action against perpetrators of the Mumbai attacks of 2008, which resulted in loss of 165 lives, including 25 foreign nationals.
According to charge sheet, it was a result of a well-planned criminal conspiracy hatched by Pakistan-based leadership of terrorist organization Jaish-e-Mohammed and brought on record the all-out involvement of Pakistan-based entities to carry out terrorist strikes in India and to incite and provoke Kashmiri youth. Among the 19 people charge sheeted, 12 are residents of Kashmir, while 7 are Pakistani nationals. The ones from Pakistan are Masood Azhar Alvi, Rauf Asgar Alvi, Amar Alvi, Qari Yasir, Muhammad Umar Farooq, who was killed in an encounter, Kamran Ali, who was also killed in an encounter, and Muhammad Smile. They received training in Afghanistan, and 300 kg RDX used in the attack was smuggled into India from Pakistan.
Prominently, the evidences have been brought out very lucidly, in which WhatsApp log messages, voices, trails, and forensically matched voices, identity card details, photographs, extending from the planning to the execution. And it has also brought out the aspect of the money trail and the accounts which supported them.
Investigation into the case also revealed that Jaish had allegedly planned yet another attack on the security forces after Pulwama, but it was aborted due to international pressure. Despite all, Pakistan continues to shelter these terrorists and provide training to infiltrate into Jammu and Kashmir. Jammu and Kashmir police recently arrested 5 operatives of Islamic State in Bandipora and recovered maps, flags, and propaganda material from their possession. They were planning an attack on Indian Army convoy.
ये जो ग्रुप हमने पकड़ा है, ये JKIS के ऑपरेटिव्स हैं और ये यहाँ पे पिछले 2-3 सालों से अपनी गतिविधियों को अंजाम दे रहे थे। इसमें इनका यहाँ पे JKIS का फ्लैग बनाने से लेके उनकी रिक्रूटमेंट, उनकी जो वीडियोस, फोटोग्राफ्स और उनकी आइडियोलॉजी को प्रोपगेट ये 5 लोग यहाँ पे कर रहे थे।
Pakistan has been annoyed since the abrogation of Article 370 and 35A from Jammu and Kashmir. The newly formed Union Territories of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh are witnessing rapid development and peace is fast prevailing with no violence and strikes.
Hopes for peace in Afghanistan appear to be slipping away, as the Taliban has not put a halt to its offensive against Afghan security forces and civilians. The violence has ramped up since the discord over the release of the remaining 320 Taliban prisoners have hampered progress on formal talks. A report.
Months of extensive peace talks between the United States and the Taliban, a number of floating assurances, but the security situation in Afghanistan continues to remain deteriorating. Once again, a wave of attacks across Afghanistan left many people dead and wounded. A truck bomb attack on Afghan army commandos killed 5 people and injured more than 40 in the Balkh province. Moreover, several other deadly attacks were carried out over the past week in Kandahar, Ghazni, Jawzan, Baghlan and Ghor provinces of the country.
که مواد انفجاری بار بوده انفجار کرده در قراولی در نزدیکی قرارگاه کماندوی ما مگر خوشبختانه قبل از رسیدن به قراول و داخل قرارگاه توسط پیرادارای بیدار کماندو شناسایی و بالایش اجراات صورت گرفته که در نتیجه 6 نفر کماندوی ما زخمی می باشه و یک نفر هم شهید می باشه مگر بیشترین قربانیان از این حمله ملکی ها می باشند که تعداد و آمارشان تا فعلا از 30 الی 35 نفر هم افزود شده.
Violence has gripped across Afghanistan as the US backed peace talks between the Afghan government and the Taliban is facing delays. The intra-Afghan talks are the part of a US-Taliban peace agreement which was signed in February in Doha this year. However, the start of peace talks continues to hamper over prisoner release and constant bloodshed by the Taliban. According to a United Nations report, 1,282 people were killed in violence in the first 6 months of 2020 in Afghanistan and 2,176 were wounded. This has triggered a large-scale displacement of civilians in the country. In the latest report by Afghan media, more than 6,000 families in Kunduz province have been forcibly displaced, fearing attacks by the Taliban and other terror groups. This constant bloodshed is the clear manifestation of human rights violations by the Taliban and their insensitive attitude towards Afghans. Thus, expected resumption of talks could signal a new phase for the country's government, but what this means for the Afghan people is still unclear.
It's not just random killing of Afghan citizens, that's part of it, but there is also selectivity in this. For example, they are choosing ethnic groups like the Hazaras. The Taliban want basically is absolute control over Afghanistan. And you remember, when they controlled Afghanistan, the non-Pashtun and the non-Sunni minorities were treated like third-class citizens. So when people talk about a post-resolution Afghanistan, what they have in mind or what the Taliban has in mind is the time when they had held absolute sway and they did whatever they liked within that particular country. And this does not augur well for the future of Afghanistan.
Under the landmark Doha peace deal, the Taliban pledged to combat other extremist and terrorist groups, mostly based in Pakistan, and deny them from using Afghan soil to launch attacks. However, the fact is that promises made by the Taliban are vague, and it continues to maintain ties with regional and Pakistan-based terror groups. According to a United Nations report released in June this year, the Taliban still maintains close links to Al-Qaeda and sought its advice during recent negotiations with US officials. The UN report also highlights the fact that terror groups such as the Taliban, Al-Qaeda, ISIS and TTP are working in cahoots with each other to spread mayhem across South Asia.
The Taliban believes the Americans are leaving and the Americans are leaving. I believe what will happen in spite of the Taliban not wanting it is that the various factions of the anti-Taliban groupings will come together. Yes, it is true that the Taliban wants the Americans out because they think they can enter into Kabul and just take it away. Remember, whenever the Taliban has made frontal attacks against the Afghan National Army, it has been rebuffed. Taliban only is effective when it indulges in terrorist acts where collateral damage is very, very high. In the event of the Americans going away, it will be a full frontal war between the Afghan National Army and the Taliban. And I doubt whether the Taliban will find the going as easy as it thinks it will be. It will not be that easy. But yes, it is an agreement they are signing in bad faith in the hope that the Americans will go away and then they will walk into Kabul. But that is not going to be easy.
The United States says that there is no military solution to the ongoing conflict and has already reduced its troops under a troop withdrawal agreement. But the continuous surge of violence in the country is suggestive of an unchanged stance and strategy of the Taliban despite all peace attempts. Peace and stability in Afghanistan will only prevail when the Taliban shun violence and join the mainstream.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We'll be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Shreyasa Vijay signing off on the behalf of entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.